So, Jim, you made this?
Yep.
Jim made this. How do you make something like this? Is it hard?
Well, no. It started as a clay sculpture. And then I took a mold of the sculpture, a plaster mold. And I pull the mold off, get all the junk clay out of it, close it back up again, flip it over, pour it right up to the top of the neck with liquid latex. That sits for an hour or two. Pour off the excess, dry overnight, yank it.
Sounds hard.
Paint it up, nothing to it.
Cool.
You'd seen that he was posting online was the command patches. It was like, now that he's here, they're here, they're here.
Cool. How many Gorons are there going to be? Four?
Four. Or possibly more, depending on what our CGI guy, one of our CGI guys, Ken Thompson, what he can come up with.
As long as they don't look like Enterprise Gorons, I'm happy.
He's talking about creating set extensions for Gorn branch.
Thank you.
Nobody's and perfect.
He's talking about creating set extensions for the Gorn bridge. And
but behind you. See the ring behind the leg of the chairs?
Oh, is that a Gorn pistol?
Yeah, it got a little busted in shipping, but we're going to glue it back together.
A Gorn phaser?
Yep.
So we never actually saw a Gorn weapon, right? So this how did you come up with the design?
When Kirk and Salaith were thrown down on the planet, they were thrown there with no weapons. They had to create something to kill each other with. So. But this is, we had to come up with what does a Gorn weapon look like.
Now you can shoot this.
Gorn Disruptor created by Jim Bray. Starship Ajax. Jim, did you make the disruptor also?
Yes.
Very talented.
You're too kind, sir. I've always made props and stuff. And
I think I'm doing.
Start out as a hobby.
No, flip the trigger prop around the other way. There, seeing that the end of it rests on the.
I got you.
And then that catches it right there. There you go.
Like I saw.
There, and there's your display, and that's for you. To go with the rest of your artifacts on your shelf there.
Good Lord.
How are you?
How's it going?
Going good.
There are your jewels and your knob.
I don't know where that is.
Jewels and knobs, that don't sound good.
Oh, it goes over here. Oh, yeah.
Props. And speaking of props, I brought pops.
Pops or props?
Props.
A phaser.
Props. Pops.
Phasers.
You didn't make those, did you?
Yes, he did.
This one I did.
Oh, goodness.
This one's factory, so.
Is that your model?
Yes.
No. Show them which one is the $5 phaser.
Repairs.
Okay. This is the real one.
Does phaser one actually come out?
Yes.
Cool. Yeah. You gotta admit those phasers were cool. They're still cool looking.
Yeah.
And little Halloween toys repainted to act as stunt phasers. These are the ones that may get tossed about or be on extras in the background, stuff like that. Hopefully they look okay.
How long did you take to make it?
Through the painting process and everything, half a day.
Wow. He can churn them out.
Yeah, but you were doing like three or four at a pop, weren't you?
We've got...
you set up an assembly line, basically.
We've got over 10 of them, so plenty to go around.
I want to fire a phaser.
And they're really cool.
You'll get your chance, Mr. Witherspoon.
It's my lifelong dream to fire a phaser.
It's come out.
Yeah, I just did that.
And
you mean the back
fins
things?
Come out, uh-huh. And I have the metal replacements for them. Okay. So they'll have shiny metal.
I know, but you can't. I can't ever figure out why they come out.
We can put the shiny metal ones in. Make them look that much more cooler.
Okay. But yeah, lots of props. John's worked on some props. Jim certainly has worked on some props, and I guess he's already shown a couple of things we're going to be using in the movie. Yep.
Well, he's doctoring up some now. One fail down.
An absolute master at all that stuff, so we're glad to certainly have him.
Yeah, I told Jim.
I have fun.
I told Jim he was the biggest celebrity we've had down here in a while.
And I guffawed.
Since Rock
Hudson,
I think.
What I've brought with me to discuss with Jim today is an itinerary for the meeting we're going to have on the 26th. And plus some contract details, because everybody that's involved is going to have to sign a contract. So just to kind of make sure everybody's on a level playing field and we all understand.
Kind of a non-disclosure agreement.
That's correct.
Yeah. Yeah, just so that we can keep it all under wraps until everything gets out there.
I read about
those.
You
know, no spoilers.
No spoilers.
No spoilers.
No spoilers.
Hey, I'm like James Doohan. I never talk about anything.
Sorry, you didn't understand me? No spoilers.
We'll have to say that in every language.
Okay, I think I got everything just about fixed. If you want to shoot all the neat dishes we got.
I'm not sure.
Jim, if you could tell us all what they are.
I have no idea. These are engineering tools, basically. Well, these two are medical tools. Over here.
These are all Federation.
All knowledge of Krypton is in here. No.
This is all Federation. Yeah, this is all something, some new stuff for our engineer's toolkit.
Jim.
Now, the only one I really recognize is the...
Found this old Rubbermaid lunchbox. It's from the 1960s. And it just happened to be, look at this, the right color.
Yep. And it looks like something Scotty would carry.
Yeah, yeah. So everything goes in here.
So and you for some strange reason, in amongst Jim's props, he designed another prop, evidently from Superman, because all of the information of Krypton is stored in this crystalline rod.
Funny man, Dr. Jones. Universal translator.
Yep. All these were made by Jim himself, also.
Companion, the man must continue.
He used that on the airplane.
This is our Starfleet barbecue fork. It's another engineering tool.
And that was one actually used in the show. Yeah, I remember Scotty using that in the Jeffries tube.
And then there's this one, yeah, the...
Is that the one where Scotty said...
Hyperspanner tuning fork thingamabob.
Is that when he said, I know what time it is? We'll have to keep telling me, like, you're a cuckoo clocker.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was that one.
Anita Blumen cuckoo clocker.
And I still don't know what he was doing.
Something important to save the ship. He's doing important stuff. Leave him alone. Quit picking on him. And then, I don't know if you got a shot of this one yet.
No.
There we go.
That looks almost like an electric sensor.
Yeah. I didn't know if any of these had any lights in them.
Well, this one does.
Okay.
The rest don't. But I've got some stuff where I was going to kind of take around. Brought some bits and pieces to see if I could make a couple. Since you specified in the script a tool that lights up.
That's right.
There's this one where you could kind of go. Ah, there we go.
What is that one?
It does.
We don't know yet.
It does something important.
It does something important.
Well, Gene Roddenberry always said, don't bother explaining it. Just all that matters is that it works.
Yeah. That's something they kind of dropped in the. They kind of dropped that in the later Star Treks.
Yeah.
His best explanation when somebody asked him, "What exactly does a tricorder do?" He said, "It does anything that the script says it does."
Yeah.
That's
whatever.
Basically, the truth
requires it to do. That's what it does.
Okay, we need something to scan this.
Which is an excellent answer to that question. It's like.
Well, that was like star dates and everything else that was meant to be vague on purpose.
Yeah.
That's how we came to Treknobabble in the other Star Trek.
Yes,
that's correct.
Because everything has an excuse and a reason.
Yep. It works. What else do you need to know?
And we're sitting there with our hand on our head thinking, oh, come on.
It does what?
Do we need to know this?
Yeah, let's carry on with the story. The story was the thing. Whatever gets us there, whatever solves the problem. Well, I have this tool in my back pocket.
What's that tool? Oh, we don't know. That's
another
right.
Engineering tool.
Our engineer's going to have a lot of fun.
I hope so.
Don't fall on the equipment.
Ow.
Be careful.
All right, we're going to get some of this stuff back in the box where it doesn't get hurt anymore. Terrible things happen in shipping. Now, you might notice, you might want to get a close-up here. Kids will recognize the end of that. It's from a light bright.
Wow. I actually used to have a light bright.
Yes, so did I, obviously. Well, many, my kids did.
Many years, they still make them.
Oh, sure they do.
They don't advertise them.
Absolutely they do. And that one goes there. And this one goes in a hole. Ooh. Oh, maybe not. Well, one of these goes somewhere, by God.
Where'd you happen to find this little tool holder? Was it something you dug out of the garage and didn't know it was there? Or?
It was in a closet somewhere. I discovered it. It was just
what was it originally?
Lunchbox. It was a lunchbox. It used to have a lid that went on it, too.
What were the holes for?
Well, I made that part of it.
Oh, okay.
And just
cut when each you put your candy bar and you put the banana in here. And
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
A little juice.
It's where my juice box goes.
Charlie, they got a lot of work done on the bridge, didn't they?
Yeah, this is looking real good.
There right was now. Only one station when I was here last.
Actually, for the last...
Anyway, at some point, I'm sure you'll see an engineer going down. So we'll have this in that scene where they're making repairs.
That's not bad. That's not bad at all.
You know, going down with the toolbox.
Because believe it or not, sometime in the story, something will happen to the ship and something will need to be repaired. How original.
It's a constant.
John!
It's in every film.
I was going to ask him if he brought those red and green spanners. They look like a big clamp.
I thought I saw him. But he's on a break again.
Stop that!
Smoke
there
break.
There we go. Gorn gun is repaired.
Gorn gun looks heavy.
And one of the things that really fascinated me was... I had seen pictures of this, and the pictures did not do it justice. I thought it was going to be a little pea shooter.
Noisy cricket.
Noisy cricket, right.
Right, new.
And when I saw this and we pulled it out of the box, I was like, oh my God, yeah, this is fantastic.
Well, you realize getting shot by that being human looks like it just vaporized.
Cut you right in half, yeah.
Do Gorns even have stun settings?
Check.
That one's if you do that down, right there, what if you brought
that one just paralyzes you and you never walk again, right. This one kind of fixes it in place, and that one that you set all the way up to kill, and then this one is, I don't know what that one does.
Hey, wait, don't touch that.
I don't know if I want to know.
Auto destruct.
But anyway, you know.
You vaporize Michael and we won't have no story.
You know, the gemstones here channel the beam, and then this focuses.
Don't aim that at me.
And then just a minute here, let's...
We need more gun control.
Oh, dang.
More Gorn control.
Yeah.
We need more Gorn control.
That would be a nice thing to post on Facebook.
Yes, more Gorn control.
More Gorn control.
Oh, gosh.
Here's some more gems.
Yeah, so everything you had in there...
Jim, you actually ordered those gems from online?
Oh, here's some neat little blankies that I was going to make into props.
Oh, wow.
So do that. And
then, hope that shows up. That's neat.
Well, let me press that again. Come on, you. There we go.
I can see it.
Maybe we could attach that to one of the engineering tools.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
He finally, remember when we posted the Ajax Picasso?
Yeah, what else?
Yeah.
He finally found it.
Oh, cool.
How long has that been?
I don't know, a couple of months.
I was going to make this into something. I haven't quite figured it out yet.
Hell no, man. This is the moment we've been waiting on.
This is actually a respirating tool.
It looks neat.
I can open it up.
It's kind of funny when you learn things about the old Star Trek, like McCoy's surgical tools or salt and pepper shakers and all this kind of stuff. And you're thinking, really?
That could look cool.
Nebulizer?
It's from a nebulizer. It's a breathing tool. I personally like it this way. I think that looks
good. Would it be some kind of scanner?
You absolutely. Get it in the shadow here where it really shows up.
Yeah,
some kind of scanner or
looks dangerous.
Repair device.
Show me the
business end is fun.
The gun dealer you had earlier.
Yeah.
I didn't get that one. These are just like props you don't know what you're going to do with yet. Right?
Yeah, they're in the midst of construction. They're just kind of... I'm just kind of toying with ideas right now about neat little...
This is for episode 10.
Correct.
Yes.
We got you on contract for...
Oh, yeah. Oh,
okay, very
for
good.
For a while.
So we don't have to kill you off in episode 9?
There we go.
Okay.
Just be able to bring me back.
Just bring you back? Okay, we can do that.
Seeing it changes colors.
Barely see it. I think the light's super bright.
Oh, I like that a lot.
Yeah, that's neat. Definitely looks alien.
And it changes fast, too.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
It's doing who knows what, you know. So I was thinking we could always, you know, put something in the end of it. Like that.
This is creative stuff.
Switch it around the other way. That's kind of neat. I mean, there's no end to what you can do.
This is like Felix the Cat's hat. You just reach your hand in and something else comes out.
Oh, I sent a bag of tricks ahead of me.
Box of tricks.
My box of fun. Close this up so I don't lose the floss. See, and it's just got stuff inside that you use in your Easter basket.
Fairy hair.
Yep. Anything else? That's pretty much it for now. That's all we got to play with today. Bag of gems for the control panels and stuff. Oh, we just have fun. I can't tell you how much fun we have. It should be illegal. We have more fun than should be allowed.
Yeah, I'm in the Rush Limbaugh saying, one of the few I like, more fun than a human being should be allowed to have.
Yes.
Yeah. I like that saying.
And I'm telling you, every time I walk onto this bridge when they've got it lit up like this, I walk in and I go, like a little kid. I'm like a little kid at the candy store. I love this. I mean, since I was, I don't know, preteen, started watching Star Trek, come home from school, get my homework done real quick, because that was a rule, man. Get your homework done. We got to do before you can do what you want to do. Which I've been trying to ingrain into my kids. They're not taking to it. But...
We're not taking
good. There's nothing we want to watch.
And then I get to watch Star Trek. And I just gobbled it up. And I was like, boy, someday I'd love to work on something like that. You know, I got into theater in high school. And just it kind of tore off from there. And
I was the same way.
Yeah. Same deal.
Yeah, like all those guys had that same story.
Yeah,
sure. Did we all play Star Trek when we were?
Oh my God!
Out in the damn field.
Well, we used to have a bar. We used to have a bar in the living room. It was this piece of countertop and it curved around like this. And my dad decided to take that whole area where the bar was and build a big pantry for my mom. So he closed it off and he threw the bar down in the basement. And the basement was where I did all my plan and building stuff. And so I took that bar and I drilled it full of holes and stuck Christmas lights through it. And I go down there and play Star Trek. That was my command center, you know.
I can see the parents. Jim,
I'll why be are there right holes up. In the Supper's table? Supper's getting cold. I'll be right up, Mom. Just a minute.
The table's blinking.
Just a minute. Come down here and look at this. Yeah, that's really cool. Will you get upstairs, please?
We got to limit his Star Trek.
Can't leave now, Mom. Captain Kirk's stranded on the planet. I'm trying to fix the transporter.
You got to get a real job, son. I mean, even when I was a scenic artist working, you know, for Disney and Universal, my dad would go, "That's nice. When are you going to get a real job?"
Wow.
Dad, wow. I have 100 people under me. Okay.
You remember Roddenberry's dad? My whole dad went down the street apologizing to the neighbors. I just saw a documentary on that on Netflix about Gene Roddenberry's creation of Star Trek, BBC show. You guys seen that?
I haven't seen it, but I know it's out there.
Is it the one where his son is doing the reconnection with his father?
Yes, that's an excellent film.
That one was pretty good.
I mean, it's good for a young man to figure out. You know, at the time, I really kind of just blew through this, and it didn't really matter to me at the time.
It was just dad doing his work.
It was dad doing his work, and then, you know, as he got older and realized, holy cow, dad really had a profound effect on a lot of people.
A lot of people.
I mean, you know, he really contributed to, you know, a lot of people's lives and stuff.
Still doing it.
I
mean, probably never end.
Look around you.
It's like, yeah. I remember an interview Leonard Nimoy did quite a while ago. He said, you know, my life, Star Trek's over for me, but, you know, this is a show that'll be around long after I'm gone. People will still be talking about Star Trek, and that's...
And a lot of people went, and a lot of people said to him, you got an ego on you, don't you? Guess what? He was right.
Oh, yeah.
The man knew what he was making, and he knew what he was doing. And the message he was wanting to send got out there, you know.
Yeah.
And here it is. And we're trying to keep it alive.
Stronger today than, you know, ever been. Probably never end. It'll always be around in some form. If it's not movies or TV show, it'll be in print, books. It'll always be around somewhere.
Well, I think for us, what this is about is we love it. We enjoy it so much. And we don't care what people say. What are you doing? You know what? We're having fun. We're meeting really cool and interesting people. We're making all kinds of new friends who get us and we get them. And we're all connecting on the same level. And just people of all different stripes. And just all of us, we found that place where we all relate and are very happy with the situation. Yeah. And it works so well. And we found a way to focus what we love into something creative and interesting that other people can enjoy.
And harmless, you know, it's not hurting anybody.
Nobody's
it's something
hurt.
Positive.
Well, except for our wallets. But other than that...
the wallets are taking a pounding.
The wallets are taking a pounding.
Yeah.
But
sometimes
you can't take it with you, man, and you gotta enjoy yourself, and you can't you can't find the kind of friends that you find doing this, I think.
You know, I remember real,
genuinely decent, nice people with a great love for all things.
James Cawley said it the best. I get to wake up in the morning and play Star Trek. Yep. Yep, I mean, you know.
Can it get any better than that? No, yep. I don't think it can.
Now, definitely part of the bucket list.
This is the big one on the bucket list.
Yeah, it's definitely part of the bucket list. It's a dream come true, especially for me. Hopefully for everybody else that's involved with the project. I want everybody to get their fair share of the piece of this.
Mm-hmm.
So
we're in for the win.
Well, it's something that you can definitely be proud of.
Failure's not an option.
That's right. And we've decided on the commissioning plaque that's going to hang over here next to the turbo lift. That is going to be the ship's motto. Failure is not an option.
It's a good motto.